The Sustainable State, The Future of Government, Economy, and Society. Written by Chandran Nair. Read by Peter Noble. This book is dedicated to my late brother, Venu Nair. It is also dedicated to the global majority who are subject to the harsh realities of an unsustainable path to growth and prosperity, the fruits of which are enjoyed by a minority. All proceeds from direct sales of the book by the Global Institute for Tomorrow and from worldwide royalties will be directed toward furthering the debate on the nature of the sustainable state. This will be done by organizing workshops, conferences, and debates across the world. Preface. The seeds of this book were planted soon after my first book, Consumptionomics, Asia's Role in Reshaping Capitalism and Saving the Planet, was published. One idea I outlined in the book was the need for the state to take a more active role in resource allocation to avoid a catastrophe in the developing world. Another was for their societies to be organized such that collective welfare took precedence over individual rights. As one might expect, I was often attacked as a communist, an anti-capitalist, or, most annoyingly, a poor, misguided Asian environmentalist. This led me to connect the dots among everything I'd read, seen, heard, and experienced in 30 years of travelling and working around the world on development, environmental, and sustainability issues. I wanted to explore the role of the state in a constrained and overcrowded planet. This drew on project work in almost all the major countries in Asia and 5 years in Africa, and professional engagements and visits to the Middle East, Europe, Australia, and the US. I used every opportunity to immerse myself in local knowledge and conditions, which continues through my work with the Global Institute for Tomorrow. I used international forums on sustainability to test the waters on an idea that was becoming clearer to me each day, that only a strong state can help the world's large developing nations navigate the 21st century's sustainability challenge. More often than not, I was labelled as an extremist and a pessimist who did not believe in human ingenuity and progress. Nothing could be further from the truth. But after listening carefully to the arguments of many who spoke to me and what was presented as fact at global events, I increasingly believed that the arguments at the core of most current approaches were weak. I concluded that most of the approaches widely accepted as received wisdom, based on free markets, technological advances, and the spread of democracy, were simply wrong. In fact, the working title for this book was The Indispensable State. Interestingly, I did not get much pushback from Asians, Africans, and others in the developing world. It was the growing support I received from many in Asia that convinced me of the need to write this book. This book is an attempt to contribute to a new narrative of sustainable development. This narrative must come from parts of the world that are confronted with the real sustainability challenge at a scale and level of impact the West has never experienced and never will. Yet leadership on this issue has only been provided by the West. This book will attempt to broaden the discussion in the hope that leaders in the developing world will rethink their approaches and expectations regarding development, growth, and sustainability. It will ask more fundamental questions about the reach of our rights and freedoms in the face of an existential threat. It is also my hope that Western economic development and academic institutions, as well as thought leaders, will consider these arguments and pause before they provide advice to the developing world on the challenges of sustainability. The book hopes to get the world's non-Western elites, who are comfortable with Western ideas, to think again regarding the future of their countries, for which much is at stake in the face of the global sustainability challenge. They have usually attended Western colleges and graduate schools, and likely spent part of their lives in Western cities. They may even have worked for Western multinationals. They may have close connections with important and prominent people in the West. Thus, when it comes to sustainability challenges, they rely on Western ideas rather than radical new ones, even though they live at the front line. Rather than go to Yangon, Dhaka, or Chennai, they would rather go to the comfortable surroundings of Harvard, MIT, or Cambridge. This book is for them. This book is also for the next generation of young leaders who have ambitions to make a difference and be the change. There are many examples of how these young elites, deemed to be leaders of the future, can be stuck in groupthink on key global issues. To belong to such prestigious groups requires some acquiescence to the feel-good approaches as defined by the great and the good. Thus, on cue, they march to the same drumbeat. They say they want to make the world a better place, but don't ask the hard questions. They're young, but seeking legitimacy means avoiding radicalism. They align themselves to do-good causes, often the usual suspect topics and linked to philanthropy. They seek business solutions and try to build a social enterprise. If it involves technology and venture capital, all the better. I've spoken to such groups on many occasions and am surprised at how difficult and discomforting it is for them, mainly those from the developing world, to open their minds to a new conversation and particularly to a new historical perspective. What they find most difficult is the challenge posed to them about how they are the victim of westernization, yet perpetuated without trying to take the best from both worlds. It is often emotionally difficult for them to process, yet they are meant to be the next generation of leaders where so much hope is placed. They openly express support for sustainability and other such causes and say they seek change, but the change they seek is skin deep, as they're unwilling to accept the core challenge in the sustainability crisis, that Asia and the rest of the developing world will need to take a very different path than the West and must reject the West's unsustainable economic and political systems. This book is for them, too. Finally, this book is for those who are working on these issues but feel that current approaches are weak and do not relate to the conditions and realities they experience. They've been searching for something new, a different narrative that speaks to their appreciation of the issues and realities. In the absence of this, they've succumbed to the tired narratives, lost their radicalism, become cynical, or given up. I hope this book captures some of their narrative and that they will help mainstream it for those who will come after them. This book is for them, too. Introduction. The Indispensable State, Sustaining Our Future. In 2012, I travelled to Yuyu County, nestled in the northwestern corner of China's Shaanxi province. It can be easy to assume and expect that Yuyu County, like large parts of central China, is a dusty, arid, semi-desert, especially after you learn that almost 90% of the local economy is driven by coal mining. But Yuyu County isn't brown, it's green. Forests and grasslands blanket the landscape, holding back the nearby deserts. This wasn't always the case. The county is close to the Ordos Desert, which had steadily expanded into the region due to soil erosion and drought. In 1949, over three-quarters of the region's land had been affected by desertification. This was clearly bad on its own terms, but the desertification also had serious effects on the county's development. Agriculture was difficult, which kept incomes low and kept people in poverty. Those who could leave often did. An old rhyme from Yuyu puts the issue more plainly. It was so dark that people needed lamps during the day. At night, the sand will bury your door, which won't open in the morning. Once windy, there was a sandstorm. Once rainy, there was a flood. The hills were bare like the head of a monk. 9 out of 10 years, there was no harvest. Most men left in search of better lives. The ladies left behind dug wild herbs to feed themselves. Nowadays, desertification is one of China's major national environmental priorities. The country's expanding deserts are blamed both for swallowing up large tracts of arable land and for worsening the air pollution crisis in Beijing and other major cities. China has launched many programs to combat desertification, from tree planting campaigns to moving communities away from overgrazed and overfarmed regions. The Chinese government is now starting to plant forests, a green necklace, across the Hebei-Beijing border to help combat creeping desertification and large-scale pollution from the manufacturing-driven Hebei province. But in Yuyu, the fight against desertification started much earlier. The county's first party chief, upon taking office in 1949, reportedly stated that the county's development guideline should be to be rich, stop the sandstorm. To stop the sandstorm, plant more trees. Over the decades, this approach made the county a national leader in reforestation. Government officials took pride in their work, even as China's opening to the rest of the world and subsequent rapid growth highlighted flashier symbols of development. When I was there, I was told that when the county mayor was promoted to a new position elsewhere in the country, the only souvenir he took from his office was the beat-up shovel he used during his 12 years in Yuyu. Today, Yuyu is called a green pearl. Far from the barren desert landscape of decades past, the numbers are truly staggering. At the founding of the People's Republic of China in October 1949, only about 0.3% of Yuyu County was covered in forest. By 2016, this number had risen to 54%, higher than both the national average, 21.36%, and the world average, 32%. Water and soil erosion during the rainy season have been reduced by as much as 60%. The number of sandstorm days has been halved. Desertification has been effectively halted in its tracks, and the planting of trees has become a revered activity for all age groups in this rural population. Controlling the sandstorms unlocked Yuyu's economic potential. The county has replaced traditional subsistence farming with high-quality, high-efficiency, ecological agriculture. The forests have also encouraged tourism, with over 700,000 visitors to the county in 2010. Yuyu is a shining example of not just environmental protection, but also environmental regeneration and achieving long-term sustainability objectives. But it took heavy government intervention and unusual leadership over a period of decades to hold back the desert. The government devised a strict blueprint for reforestation that was followed for over half a century, spanning two generations. Party cadres became forest directors, responsible for tree planting. Finally, the government organized the people into a mass reforestation movement, which supported the efforts of the state, thereby also gaining legitimacy at the same time. It's hard to think of another country that has actively reforested its countryside in this way over two generations, in such extreme conditions, and certainly none can be found in the developing world. Yuyu's officials had a great deal of authority, but they were passionate about governance and improving the lives of society as a whole. And in turn, the people trusted their leaders' judgment and worked over several decades to support their objectives. It's worth asking a potentially bold question. Could the Indian government reforest one of its states in this way? Would Indonesia's government be able to reforest vast parts of Kalimantan, Borneo, where, very fortunately, the climate would easily support such an effort? Or could the US launch such a large-scale program of reforestation? To ask an even more bold question about the role of the state in attaining sustainability goals, would the US be able to build a network of high-speed trains across the country, and thus reduce the carbon footprint of the transportation sector, as China has done? Are these countries capable of turning the tools of the state towards sustainability, resource protection, environmental regeneration, and survival? Throughout my career, Both as the former chairman of Asia's largest environmental management consultancy and currently as the founder of a Pan-Asian think tank focused on economic development and sustainability, I've come away from countless conferences and meetings about sustainable development with business leaders, government officials, and NGOs with the same nagging thought. Very few people seem, from what they say and write, to have truly grappled with the multidimensional and global scale of the sustainability challenge and confronted the realities and the brutally honest nature of the solutions needed, apart from actions untested in policy to date against global climate change, an important part of the sustainability challenge, but only a part. This is not to say that people do not grasp the severity of the problem, nor that they are not passionate in trying to find solutions. Instead, it would appear that the current conversation about sustainable development is based on several flawed premises that distract us from coming up with real solutions that will require painful adjustments, especially by the global haves, and redefining our ideas about prosperity. The idea of sustainable development has become confused with pollution reduction, being environmentally friendly, or even just being environmentally conscious. This has allowed many organizations across the world, especially businesses, to paint their actions as improving their sustainability and tackling the global challenge. Actions as small as an office lowering the temperature setting of its air conditioning, and as indirect as Coca-Cola's sponsorship of a water use reduction conference, are placed under the umbrella of sustainability, in spite of the fact that both entities either engage in massively unsustainable practices themselves or encourage them in others. Organizations such as the UN have, in my view, muddied the waters by not taking a clear position and instead creating platforms such as the Global Compact, where multinational corporations can showcase their all too often superficial attempts at sustainability while allowing the UN to promote its engagement business and thus claim it is being fair and inclusive to all stakeholders. Even worse, these platforms have become respected institutions, thus not even allowing well-informed UN officials to be intellectually honest for fear of upsetting corporate members of the Global Compact and the numerous other business advisory councils it has created. Here is why environmental awareness is not the same as being sustainable. Being green is about reducing the environmental costs of economic activity and other human impacts, such as proper disposal of human waste. In this day and age, one could even say that taking action about the environmental impacts associated with economic activity is simply doing the decent thing, which should be no badge of honour. Sustainability goes deeper than harm reduction. It concerns the management of common and public resources to ensure they are not overused or abused, so that all people have fair and equal access to them. Perhaps it would be best to start from first principles. Sustainability is the ability of a system to survive indefinitely by not using or abusing resources faster than its ability to replenish itself. A more sustainable economy, therefore, is one with a smaller gap between its use or abuse of resources and the Earth's ability to renew them. Some green techniques, though good on their own merits, do not reduce this gap. In other words, all sustainable systems are green, but not all green systems are sustainable. Development, by contrast, refers to the provision of basic needs and standards of living to a population that constitutes an improved quality of life. A developed economy is one that largely provides basic needs universally among its entire population. By contrast, a developing country has yet to achieve this. The basic needs include, but are certainly not limited to, safe and secure food supply systems, clean water, safe and sturdy shelter, basic energy systems, sanitation, and high-quality healthcare and education. Like sustainability, development has become a broad term. Some use it to refer to high economic growth, even if fundamental living standards have not improved for a large part of the population. Some tie it to modernization, especially along Western lines. This often links development with flashy symbols of modernity. Skyscrapers in Shanghai, Kuala Lumpur, or Manila are seen as proof of development, even as poverty continues to exist not far from the city centre and targets the majority. The newest development fad is the internet, with exaggerated claims that connectivity is a must to address issues of poverty alleviation and will also help the cause of sustainable development. The new development paradigm seems to have more to do with fibre optics and satellites to connect everyone than with toilets, sewers, water supply networks, and proper roofs. There is also a bad habit of deeming unfamiliar systems as undeveloped, even if they get better results. The West can be particularly guilty of this, calling countries that follow Western models of economics and politics to be more developed, even if the results are growing inequality, and even if non-Western models have had better results. This return to first principles leads us to the idea of sustainable development, the improvement of living standards and provision of basic needs in a manner that does not consume or abuse resources at a faster rate than they are replenished, and that also preserves the right of future generations. My first book, Consumptionomics, was a critique of the increasingly common economic approach in Asia to ape the Western model of consumption-led growth. I argued that by focusing on consumption, high rates of economic growth, and Western-style development, Asia was putting itself on the road to ruin. Massive overconsumption would greatly strain the region's already fragile environment and worsen the consequences for the very poor, suffering from the effects of scarcity, pollution, and climate change. It would ultimately have catastrophic global impacts due to the fact the region is home to 60% of the world's population. Consumptionomics highlighted a problem in how we understand economics and economic development. But that leads us to the next question. If the world should not use relentless consumption based on the underpricing of externalities as its engine for further development, what should governments use instead? In a world of hard resource constraints, what would constrainomics look like? That in turn raises more difficult questions about rights and freedom in a resource-constrained planet. Is car ownership a human right? If the world, and especially Asia, are to get through a hot and crowded 21st century, they need a new model for economic development and new definitions of prosperity and freedoms. They need a new political philosophy and uplifting vocabulary about human progress in an era of constraints, beyond simplified slogans that conflate rights and freedom of choice. There is little in past economic history that matches the scale of the coming challenge. In fact, past models have likely served to make the problem worse. There is no template for this challenge. And for the global majority in Asia, Africa, and South America to look to the West and its institutions for solutions is the height of folly. Something new is needed, and this book is an attempt to figure out what that might be. The book aims to ask some highly inconvenient questions, expose some of the fallacies at the heart of the sustainability discourse from the viewpoint of a developing world reality check, and postulate some solutions. But it is not going to arrogantly suggest that these solutions are the blueprint for addressing all the challenges we face. This will not be an attempt to devise a solution for the world as a whole. Developed economies cannot run away from the fact that they have a disproportionately large footprint per capita without the added challenge of achieving basic living standards for their people. But the world's majority, with a much smaller footprint per capita, lives in China, India, Indonesia, Nigeria, Brazil, and the rest of the developing world. Their footprints will, and must, increase. These countries still need to achieve a basic standard of living for all their people as the majority continued to be mired in poverty. yet the only development models available to them are unsustainable and borrowed from the West. There is, as of now, no answer to what I will call the India question. How can India, a country of 1.2 billion, peaking at 1.5 billion in 2050, lift hundreds of millions and perhaps as much as half a billion out of poverty in the next 30 years, yet also curtail its emissions and resource use at the same time? All the economic development models available to India would release huge amounts of emissions, produce mountains of waste, overuse resources, and create even more pollution, and would thus worsen the global sustainability challenge. However, India, with some justification, argues that it would be unfair to deny better living standards to its hundreds of millions of people, and so should strive to standards attained by Europeans and Americans by employing the same approach to development. In a perfect world, India would be absolutely right. But as the book will argue, this will not be possible, and this problem encapsulates the sustainable development challenge for the developing world. India is not alone in needing to pursue sustainability and development at the same time. Despite huge progress in alleviating poverty globally, mainly in China, many in the global majority are still not provided with basic needs. According to the World Bank, 700 million people still live on less than $2 a day. 1 in 10 people lack access to clean water. 1 in 3 does not have a proper toilet, despite having a mobile phone. Then you have the hundreds of millions who, although not living in abject poverty, still do not have a reasonably comfortable living standard with access to good education, a safe home, and health care for themselves and their families. However, the current attempts by developing countries to improve the livelihood of their people, while successful in alleviating abject poverty, have also had huge repercussions in terms of environmental degradation and resource depletion, not to mention social costs. Cramped cities with inadequate housing are choked by smog and poor waste disposal, which creates huge public health risks for residents. Ancient forests, reservoirs of biodiversity, are cut down to make room for plantations. Groundwater and waterways are contaminated by trash, industrial and agricultural chemicals, and human waste. Then add the carbon emissions that are likely to be added by the construction of new power plants, the massive growth in car ownership levels, and the expansion of agriculture, among other activities. And one can see how this quickly becomes a global issue, even if impacts are most felt at the local level. Developing countries like India are thus currently stuck in a dilemma. Do they develop using the models available to them and risk damaging, if not destroying, their environments and impoverishing their people further? Do they lie and promise Western living standards to their people despite the fact that this will lead to ruin? The harsh truth is that they can't. But without an alternative understanding of prosperity and development, this admission is tantamount to dooming their people to perpetual poverty, a morally and politically difficult argument. This is a dilemma not addressed by Western experts and institutions, as it would raise some fundamental questions about the economic and political models being promoted, and result in all sorts of accusations that liberals are unwilling to confront. The resource footprints of countries like China, India, Indonesia, Nigeria, and Brazil will, and must, increase if they are to achieve a basic standard of living for all their people. Yet the only development models available to them are unsustainable and borrowed from Western economic and political orthodoxy. How can the developing world provide the most basic living standards for their whole population without destroying the planet in the process? This is the real challenge of sustainable development. The sustainable state focuses on how the world's poorer nations, particularly the larger ones, address the particular conundrum of uplifting hundreds of millions of people from drudgery while avoiding the worst aspects of an economic model at war with the planet and its people. However, its core argument about the indispensable role of the state is also relevant to more advanced economies, such as the US, Europe, Japan, and South Korea. But the scale and nature of the challenge are different in these richer economies. The need to share with the rest has unsettled several wealthy, modern, and democratic countries, especially as the rest begin to take their rightful place in the world after centuries of domination by the West. It has resulted in a battle between so-called globalists and populists in democratic countries, each reacting to the prospect of sharing with the rest. I've come to the conclusion that the drastic shifts and sacrifices needed in these advanced economies are unlikely to come to pass. The evidence suggests that their democratic institutions, as currently constituted, will not facilitate such changes. It is difficult to ask a population accustomed to a certain standard of living and privilege to downgrade in the interest of greater global sustainability. I certainly hope that there will be change in the rich world, but it will only happen when truly enlightened leaders emerge who are bold enough to change the narrative and create a new political philosophy that addresses the issue of collective welfare over individual rights, critiques the idea of unconstrained individual choice, and reinterprets the definition of prosperity in a constrained world. No Western leader has yet shown any appetite to do these things. Almost all, despite lofty rhetoric, seek to preserve the old order and their dominant role. One can look at France to see how the promise of radical change affects political popularity. An initially popular President Macron with fresh ideas and a desire to take the mantle of European and global leadership has seen his approval ratings plummet upon trying to reform France's old labour laws. The French population has gotten used to privileges and so resists the wider structural changes needed. Ironically, democracy allows this denial as the state remains too weak to take bold policy action. This is not to let these countries off the hook. Advanced democracies will have an important role to play as partners of the global majority when facing the challenges of the 21st century. In fact, it is in their interest. How can mature democracies become strong and thus more effective states? One can think of a few general prescriptions: more effective governance, rewriting of constitutional structures that are no longer suited to current needs and challenges, an ability to move past political gridlock, greater responsiveness to what majority public opinion actually asks for, and a more active intervention in the economy. It will also require coming to terms politically with the rise of the rest and the inevitability of sharing with others. Thus, Western economies have to stop thinking they can impose their approaches on the rest. And that means examining the role of Western-dominated international organizations, most of which were created in a different era and are now past their sell-by date, but are still hung on to in order to retain past privileges and prestige. They will also have to address their own problems, which are only likely to get more severe as their populations feel the discomfort of a more globalized world. This will require addressing the issue of why they are becoming weaker and apparently failing, and why the panacea of democracy is unable to serve their populations. I will not pretend that the sustainable state provides an answer to this question, but I hope it raises enough questions to spur a robust debate in the West and the rest of the world on the subject of sustainability and the role of the strong and effective state to resolve it. There's a school of thought that essentially argues that everything will be fine. It denies that there could be a trade-off between development and sustainability, as the free market, operating within democratic systems, will eventually self-correct. Technology would provide a panacea to social problems. As resources become scarcer, resource prices will increase, and companies will be encouraged to create more energy and resource-efficient products. Inventors may even develop entirely new technology that allows everyone to live a lifestyle that is both American and sustainable. This can be a comforting argument, as the policy prescriptions can be quite lucrative. What better win-win strategy than one that allows for going green while making money? Regulations would be discouraged, as they would interfere in the proper functioning of the market. Governments would take a step back and let the market innovate. At most, a government could subsidize tech companies in the hope that they will invent something that will allow the world to live like Americans. There may be in the distant future technologies that make a high level of consumption possible without the external environmental costs, though they would have to overcome many laws of nature and are thus highly improbable. Such technologies certainly do not exist today and may never exist in a form affordable for the developing world. Climate change and environmental devastation are happening now, and the world cannot afford to place its hopes on a deus ex machina. And this is not to even ask the question of what unrestrained consumption does to human societies, and whether it is even desirable. Most people, Western and non-Western, understand that the developing world needs an economic model that keeps a path to continued development open while using resources in a sustainable manner. They know that the expectations of the developing world must be managed, moving them away from expecting a Western standard of living, but still providing them with what I will be describing as a moderate prosperity, allowing them to live well and comfortably within limits. However, pressing for details often leads to sheepish shrugs and an admission that the problem seems unsolvable. Why? The difficulty comes from an unwillingness, mainly for our ideological reasons, to jettison our current ideas about how to organize our economies, societies, and states. There is also the difficulty of articulating the politically incorrect but honest idea that the world's majority cannot and should not aspire to live like the West. And there is the troubling thought of coming to terms with the idea of unconstrained individual rights and freedoms. This will be discussed further, but a condition for navigating the challenge in developing countries will be to create political and economic systems where collective welfare overrides individual rights. For example, many Asian cities need more cars, like I need a hole in the head, and the solution is not more technology, but restrictions on car ownership and/or usage and investments in public transport. That will infringe on individual rights, but the collective majority will benefit. The ability of individuals to exercise their right to a car in these crowded cities has created a collective nightmare. Further, there's the challenge of dispelling the well-established answer to all of this, that multinational corporations, given their immense economic power and reach, are in this struggle together with people of the world, and that together with technology will be the key to success. This is a lie. And a goal of this book is to make it clear that although corporations will play a part, often not voluntary, the challenge of sustainability is one of protecting public good, and this is neither the business nor the role of companies. After all, sustainability is about the notion of less, and corporations do not do less, they do more. To paraphrase business language, it is in the DNA of a company to innovate and do more, not less. Mainstream and Western economic and business models have put developing countries in a box where creating solutions to sustainable development is extremely difficult. A new paradigm is needed. The free market has long been the centerpiece of orthodox models of international development. Sustainable development, too, must now be achieved through the instruments of the free markets, and with the private sector taking the lead. Almost all mainstream economists would argue that the free market allocates the world's scarce resources in a way that allows them to be used most efficiently and in a way that does the most good. Assuming everything is working properly, the market would optimize society's use of resources. By extension, any move to interfere in the market's operations would lead to a worse and more inefficient outcome. But the underlying problem with the free market doctrine of development is that it puts continuous high growth as its aim, driven by consumption as its engine. barring the development of a whole range of radical new technologies and plans to facilitate their constructive use, infinite growth is impossible. Ask any eminent scientist. We already consume more resources than the Earth's ability to restore them, so we will eventually hit the hard boundaries of what our planet can provide. As long as we value growth above everything else, we will never have truly sustainable development. Governments would too often choose to boost growth in the short term by unsustainably consuming resources. In the developing world, where the majority are still disenfranchised, the growth-at-any-cost model can only lead to a bleak future. If the developing world is to truly have sustainable development, it needs to radically rethink the development consensus. It needs to change its focus on free markets, on Western versions of economics, politics, and modernity, on the free flow of capital, and other truths of development. These rules have been written by Western countries and institutions. Even though I'm sure many are sincere in their wish to improve the lives of the less fortunate, the bureaucrats that operate them still live and work in a Western context far removed from realities on the ground. They can push outdated doctrines long past when empirical evidence has proven their failure. This problem is compounded by the fact that many in the developing world accept ideas from the West unthinkingly and uncritically. One example is how Asia understands prosperity. Asians currently model prosperity after an American lifestyle: two cars, a sizable two-story house in the suburbs, a large TV, air conditioning, fast internet, and meat with every meal. Asia urgently needs to redefine what it means to be prosperous. In a more constrained era, what does it mean to live the good life? Asia also needs to redefine its attitude toward consumption. Too many societies have unthinkingly and rapidly abandoned well-established norms of frugality and now function and even thrive on the notion that all of us have a right to our own consumption. To borrow a metaphor, consumption is often perceived as innocent until proven guilty. It is deemed acceptable unless it presents clear harms to the consumer and to others, and even then, any actions must be of a light touch. But our understanding of harm does not go far enough. Instead, consumption, where externalities are not priced in, that is to say, almost everything we consume in goods and services, needs to be guilty until proven innocent. We should be aware that all consumption places costs on the resource base and also other members of society, and that it should only be approved once those costs have been recognized and accounted for. This is not to call for a utopian pricing regime for all forms of consumption, because that would not be feasible. Human survival depends on careful resource and commons usage and rent, and there are always externalities and limits involved. The challenge is to determine which ones to price appropriately, to allow for responsible levels of consumption so as to reduce negative impacts, and which ones to tolerate where impacts are not too significant or intolerable. That is ultimately the biggest role of the state, and this book will give examples of this critical balancing act the state must play in developing countries. These examples will make the point that this role cannot be abdicated by the state in the false hope that it will be fulfilled by the workings of markets and innovations by tech firms or multinationals, especially those dependent on natural resources, either as feedstock or sinks. In this regard, the state has an obligation and much to do to ensure that one person's consumption is not an absolute violation of another person's basic human rights. Someone or something needs to make these decisions on how to manage resources, economies, and expectations. The same can be said about redefining what prosperity will look like in the 21st century. What goods can a society afford to let people strive for? What standard of living is too extravagant given hard resource constraints? It should be obvious that these questions cannot be the remit of the private sector or NGOs. The private sector has no real interest in pricing in the externalities of the consumption of their goods and services, as their business models often rely on not paying for them. Carbon dioxide is just the tip of the iceberg. And why would they pay for externalities voluntarily? Thus, the private sector seeks to demonstrate care by initiatives such as corporate social responsibility and others with regard to the environment and sustainability issues. All of these have their value, and many companies do take it seriously. But as most of the specialists within the corporations know, this does not address the less versus more issue at the heart of the challenge on how societies become more sustainable. Systemic market failures, such as the gap between the private benefits and the external costs of consumption, mean that the market does not allocate resources toward long-term sustainability. The lack of a mechanism to properly price and manage public and common goods means that they are perpetually overused, leading to overproduction and, in turn, overconsumption. We need governance of the economy in order to overcome these market failures. Nor can governance be successfully exerted at the global level. Global agreements still require states to implement their directives. If states are unable or unwilling to do so, then global governance fails. Bottom-up governance, a common and romantic refrain of liberals from the West on how to manage sustainability in the developing world, would be nice to have, but is also not a viable alternative due to the reality of the erosion of village authority in relation to both the state and the global market, not to mention the need for consolidation rather than fragmentation to serve organizational purposes in developing countries. Granting authority to villages too early would likely end up worsening the problem, as weak local governments are captured by vested interests. In a perfect world, sustainability would be driven by a combination of global, state, and local governments. But we do not live in such a world. Rather than living in a world marked by the demise of the state, we instead live in a world driven by it, the only governing entity with the legitimacy, accountability, and actual ability to make the necessary political choices about the economy and the use of resources. I will readily admit that few states are perfect. Many, especially in the developing world, have serious problems with efficiency, corruption, weak institutions, incompetence, and an unwillingness both to recognize sustainability issues as central to their legitimacy and to think outside the box. Some rely too heavily on force and oppression to mask their internal weaknesses and mismanagement of their economies. However, even with spreading globalization across the world, the state is still the only governing body that a population sees as the most legitimate wielder of authority and protector of their interests. In his book India Grows at Night, the Indian author and former business leader Gurcharan Das says, "I celebrated the heroic idea that India was rising despite the state. 2 decades later, I have realized that I might have been wrong. I am now convinced that the state is of first-order importance. It can either allow human beings to flourish, or it can become the biggest obstacle to their realization of their potential. To rise without the state is courageous, but it cannot be a long-term virtue." This book argues that the sustainability challenge is what will define this century, and for the people in the large, poorer nations of the world to have a chance to flourish, not the same as living some American dystopian dream, then the state will need to be actively involved in the economy, and particularly in how the majority have access to basic resources. If states are to fulfill their role and responsibilities and provide for societies in a hot and crowded 21st century, they need to be strong. They need to be able to intervene effectively and consistently in the economy to support sustainability goals. They need to be able to resist the influence of the vested interests that currently thrive on and benefit from overconsumption, allowing others to pay the price for their buy one, get one free business models. And they need to be able to decide fairly and justly what their vision of limited prosperity should look like. Allow me to make a brief but important aside about how I understand the state. The state is often seen purely as the body that governs a society. Society and the state that governs it are thus two separate entities. It is quite easy to see how state strength can be seen as risky. State power can be turned against the people. But I believe this is distorting. States that use force and violence against their own people can seem strong at first glance, but this repression often masks deeper instability and internal weakness. I instead believe the state to be a combination of the people and the government, constituted in the relationship between them. When the people feel that they are included in governance, which responds to their needs and wants, then the relationship is strong, leading to a strong state. When this relationship is broken, then the state is weak. This is why oppression and violent coercion are not symbols of state strength. If the state were truly strong, there would be no reason for the government to resort to force in the first place. And as I will discuss in Chapter 6, the strong state as I define it is not necessarily a condition to be found only in democracies as defined by the West, and the book will highlight examples. I think it is important to understand state strength independently of how democratic a state is. A poorly designed and weak democratic system will be as incapable of addressing the challenges of sustainable development as a poorly designed non-democratic system. The point is that strong democratic and non-democratic states will be better placed to make necessary decisions about constraining consumption and spreading access to basic needs. An often used comparison is between authoritarian China and democratic India. Objectively speaking, China has had far more success than India in reducing poverty and providing basic needs for its very poor. China also seems more capable of long-term strategic thinking, from its infrastructure program to its new sustainability agenda. By contrast, India still struggles to provide basic sanitation to its population, and necessary projects, such as cleaning the Ganges River, have idled for decades. India can make grand, sweeping policy gestures, but its priorities are sometimes misplaced. This is not to say that India should emulate China's one-party authoritarian system, nor does this imply that China's performance has been perfect. Widespread environmental degradation clearly shows that China has made several mistakes in its drive to develop. But it is true that China's performance in poverty reduction and almost all spheres of development is far more successful than India's, despite the latter being a democracy. The idea that state management of the economy can be used to achieve a social goal, despite the orthodoxy of free markets, is not a new one in the literature. The success of such countries as Japan, South Korea, and China in the latter half of the 20th century gave rise to the concept of the developmental state. These governments used state investment and protection of the economy to drive modernization, mechanization, and urbanization. These models were especially suited for an increasingly global economy, as protection allowed these countries to develop globally competitive manufacturing sectors. Bucking the Western-derived orthodoxy was also helpful in insulating them from global economic and financial contagion, as shown by the different reactions to the 1997 Asian financial crisis, during which countries such as Malaysia, that ignored the IMF, did better than those that followed its prescriptions. However, the developmental states, even as they drifted from Western orthodoxy in their methods, did not stray from it in their goals. Their aim was to eventually become a Western-style economy, one with high growth, driven by consumption as the engine of growth. This extended to their populations as well, who aspired to Western standards of living and levels of consumption. This desire to ape the West and even do better, a perverse form of revenge, is deeply rooted in the psyche and culture of societies that were colonized by the West for centuries. This neurotic subservience is poorly understood by Western intellectuals, or is conveniently ignored, as it reinforces the superiority of Western ideas and offers many privileges to Western businesses and politicians. The developing world needs to instead take the lessons of the developmental state to build the sustainable state, a state that uses the tools of state management to build a 21st century economy based on providing a shared prosperity for their large populations through the management of constrained resources, containing the runaway impacts of consumption-driven economic growth and the associated externalities, yet avoiding the need to be authoritarian. That is the challenge of sustainability in the 21st century for the developing world, and this book seeks to open that debate. Some of the ideas in this book are not new. They're based on economic concepts that have been accepted for over half a century, if not longer. Many have argued about the value of state strength in solving social goals, but few books, if any, have tackled the fundamental misconceptions that have long limited the discussion of sustainable development by failing to factor in the critical role of the state. We have neglected a discussion of a whole set of options that may prove more suited to the challenges of the 21st century. The following is an overview of the contents of this book. Chapter 1 will examine the current debate surrounding sustainable development, the free market, and the role of the state. It will study how development theory has shifted away from state management and toward free market theories, and how the Western historical and political experience began to dominate the discussion. Chapter 2 will argue that the problem of sustainable development must be tackled by governments rather than by markets or technology. The free market is plagued by several systemic failures that encourage overconsumption and underpricing. Finally, the chapter will argue that technological development is unlikely to be the panacea it is often hoped to be. Chapter 3 will discuss the major element of the free market model that makes it impossible to reconcile with true sustainability. Its focus on making economic growth as high.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.